Tonight, we are in the desert of southern Arizona, and we are looking for the Arizona Tailless Whip Scorpion, otherwise known as Paraphrynus Tokdod. As you can tell, this area is a little bit flat, so I am relocating to an area where there are rock walls, where they will be far more common. Up here on the rocks, we have a Trimorphodon lambda. That is this little snake right here. This is the Sonoran lyre snake. And this one is just a juvenile. It's right around now that we're able to see juveniles like this one, because hatchlings start to emerge in late August, and you can continue to see them through October. Adults of these snakes can surpass a meter in length. You'll notice that the dorsal pattern here is very contrasted. This is a feature that you only see in small ones. As they grow, this pattern becomes more and more faded. This is because the light pigments become darker and the dark pigments become lighter. And the name lambda is after the Greek letter, basically an upside down V, and it refers to those very shapes on the dorsum, more generally referred to as chevrons. There are several species of snakes that sleep in trees at night around here, but this could be the only one that actively hunts in them nocturnally. This is not a surprise, considering that they fit a certain ecotype, that is the cat snake ecotype, if you will, and as such, they are one of the most nocturnal species of snakes that can be found in Arizona. Compared to other similar snakes, these do show up during the day a surprising amount, and almost always as juveniles. This right here is our first Paraphrynus tokdod, or the Arizona Tailless Whip Scorpion. Got it. And this one is almost full grown. Tailless Whip Scorpions, or amblypygi, are an order that contains over 100 species, with most of those species being found in tropical or subtropical environments. And the one that we have here is the northernmost ranging species in the Western Hemisphere, and it's one of the northernmost ranging species globally. In fact, out of this entire order of arachnids, I think there's only one, possibly two species that range further north than this one. And on top of that, these are also the westernmost ranging amblypygi in the world. They are found in Southern California, Nevada, Arizona, Northern Sonora, and Baja California. They live in a variety of desert habitats, and one of the main factors that determines their distribution is their upper elevational limit. These rarely ever pass 1,000 meters in elevation, and they are mostly found in rocky areas, since, like other amblypygi, they like to make use of crevices for shelter and often sit on vertical surfaces at night. However, these do appear to be more adapted to flat areas than other tailless whip scorpions. And look, there's also a Latrodectus hesperus hanging out down there. Down here on this Borrehavia plant, we have a Hyles lineata. This caterpillar right here is the larva of a white-lined sphinx moth. That name only describes the mature moths of the species, which are easily seen during twilight and all hours of the night during spring, summer, and much of fall. These are ubiquitous to the point that they can be found both in natural and urban areas, both as caterpillars and adult moths. What I've observed in this species, but not other sphinx moths in Arizona, is that they are not afraid to be terrestrial from time to time. What I mean by that is most sphinx moth caterpillars will remain on their host plant unless they are disturbed, run out of leaves to eat, or are ready to pupate, but these caterpillars appear to have so many options that they don't mind abandoning a host before exhausting the resource that it provides them. The adult moths of the species might be consistently colored, but the larvae, like the one that we have here, do vary quite a bit. Not so much by region, but rather there are various phenotypes that can exist in a single location. And that is true for the area that we are in right now. Some are quite green, and others can be nearly black. There's a Scolopendra heroes up here on this dirt wall. One of my favorite species to find out here. Let's see if this one will let me pick it up. Now that this giant desert centipede is on a stick, it should be safer to let it crawl onto my hand. This one has a little bit of growing left to do. This is undoubtedly one of the most iconic animals that can be found in Arizona, and it is one of the largest centipede species that can be found in North America. And I've already done an entire video on this species, so if that's something that interests you, I will leave a link in the description of this video. So far, this has not been a good season for seeing these Scolopendra heroes. This is the first adult that I've seen, and aside from this individual, I think I've only seen one juvenile. And this spot that we are in right now might not be the best for this species, because this is only the second one that I've ever seen in this area. This beetle down here was flying around my light before it landed. And this is a Dichotomius colonicus. It's a species of scarab or dung beetle. And this is the only species of Dichotomius in the western United States, where it's almost completely restricted to southern Arizona. There are some records occurring at the southern tip of Texas. This is in contrast with the other species of Dichotomius in the United States. That one occupies almost the entire eastern half of this country. I believe this is the largest species of dung beetle that can be found in Arizona. And while they're not that large to begin with, these are many times more massive than some of the smallest ones that are found in the region. The closest relatives of this beetle in Arizona belong to the genus Copris. They look quite similar to this dung beetle, and they're far more difficult to come by out here. You can see that the thorax of this one is smoothed over. I'm pretty sure that that indicates that this one is a female. This scorpion that's moving around here is a Centruroides sculpturatus, a very famous, or maybe I should say infamous, species. This is the Arizona bark scorpion. It is the only member of its family, Buthidae, otherwise known as the arrow-breasted scorpions, that can be found in Arizona. Of all the scorpions that can be found in this state, and there are quite a few, this one has been the most successful in expanding its range. Specifically, there are several regions across California and Nevada where these have established themselves in recent years, that being the past couple of decades, and there are potentially some other introduced populations in some other states as well. Much of what makes this possible is their ability to thrive in semi-urban environments. They also like to climb on vertical surfaces, which allows them to hitchhike on vehicles. In fact, these scorpions like to climb more than any of the other species in this state. These are frequently found in trees, especially at night, which is why they have the name bark scorpion. Several scorpions can be found in the same tree, and I've seen them more than 10 meters up on multiple occasions. And this is why their body has that gracile build. There are virtually no arboreal scorpion species in the world that also have a compact build. It's a bit difficult to see, but we have our second Paraphrynus tokdod here on the rocks. I'm just going to poke it out so you can see it better. All right, got it. This one looks to be about the same size as the first one that we found. And I forgot to mention when we found that one that individuals of this size, though they are not fully grown, they are still sexually mature. Individuals of this size are extremely easy to come by in the right areas, but ones that are of maximum size are fairly difficult to come by, at least in my experience. The specific epithet tokdod is a local indigenous word that translates to spider, and incidentally, the species of vinegaroon that can be found in Arizona is also named after a local indigenous word. And this name tokdod, which I am almost certainly not pronouncing correctly, has not been around for very long. In fact, it was just last year, in 2024, when these tailless whip scorpions were recognized as being their own species. Before that, for over a decade, they were considered to be Paraphrynus carolinae, and before that, for almost a century and a half, they were Paraphrynus mexicanus. While these Paraphrynus tokdod are found throughout a good chunk of Arizona, that other species that I mentioned, Paraphrynus carolinae, today is only known from a single locality in southern Arizona near the border of Mexico. There is an Incilius alvarius right back here, and I think I'm going to get this one off camera because these can be a little bit bouncy. All right, I have our toad. This is the Colorado River toad. This is the largest amphibian species that is native to the western United States by mass, and it's also the only species of Incilius that is found in the western half of this country. What's fairly special about this toad is the position of its poison-secreting glands. So as is the case with other toads, poison is produced in these parotid glands that are located behind the eyes, but these ones have additional glands on their hind legs as well. Not just one pair, but an additional two pairs, or a total of six combined on the entire body. And what is unique about the parotids of the Colorado River toad is that they produce 5-methoxydimethyltryptamine. And if any of you are falling asleep watching this right now, perhaps I just woke you up by saying that, because yes, I am talking about the famous hallucinogenic DMT. Or at least a structural analog of it. And that structural analog is known as 5-MeO-DMT for short. It's approximately 20 times stronger than the more well-known hallucinogenic, that being simple, DMT. And yes, as you might expect, people do seek out these toads to collect the paratoid excretions for smoking purposes. We have an Eremocosta striata hanging out in this bush, and what may very likely happen here is, as I have my light shining on it, a moth is going to go into kamikaze mode and shoo it away. But anyway, this is the first time that I've seen an Eremocosta striata up in a bush, and it's also the first time that I've seen a camel spider resting in a bush. I've seen them climbing up into bushes on several occasions. For many camel spiders, this is an easy way of grabbing a meal, but typically they don't stick around for very long, or they keep moving. Oh, and just as predicted. Although this camel spider doesn't seem to be too fussed. Oh wow, looks like it just caught a moth for itself. Oh, and it just dropped it. So sad. Down here on the ground, we have a Passimacus viridans. This beetle right here, this is a green-bordered warrior beetle. The specific epithet viridans refers to this green color that they have on their exoskeleton. It just translates to green in Latin. These are found in southeastern Arizona, southwestern New Mexico, and in northern Mexico. And across that distribution, they typically inhabit areas that are well vegetated, mostly oak forests. The area that we found this one in is a little bit on the dry side for the species' preferences. They're less common and widespread than the ubiquitous California warrior beetle, and they're also smaller on average. So I brought one with me because they are quite common around here. So if I put them next to each other, we can see them side by side. And of course, the California warrior beetle is completely black. These green-bordered warrior beetles are associated with the monsoons, which is not really the case with the California warrior beetle on the right. These are predominantly nocturnal and carnivorous, and they mainly prey on insect larvae, but they're not as picky as other beetles in the family Carabidae that are also found in this region. We have our third and final Arizona Tailless Whip Scorpion right here on the rock. Got it. And this one looks like it's about the same size as the last two as well. Many amblypygii species exclusively make use of shelter that is already available as is, such as underneath tree bark or in between crevices in rocks. But this species is special in the way that they've also been observed digging with their pedipalps, so they may occasionally modify their shelters. However, it is highly unlikely that they would dig out an entire burrow from scratch. And as I mentioned earlier, these can be seen in flat regions, and this can often mean no access to rocks. So in those instances, these tailless whip scorpions often make use of old rodent burrows, many of which may remain for years after they've been abandoned. And just like with other amblypygii, these can be commonly seen living alongside other animals, especially arthropods. It's quite common to see these living in the same holes as western widows or bark scorpions, like the ones that we've seen earlier tonight. Regarding that first one that we saw, there's a good chance that it's living in the same crevice as the widow. Around the periphery of cities and towns, these can be seen on walls in semi-urban areas. And I've noticed that another popular spot for these is in the cavities beneath manholes. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for the Arizona Tailless Whip Scorpion, or Paraphrynus Tokdod. And as always, I hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.